victory. The Blackhawks stand in their way.
When the Blackhawks and Maple Leafs play in Toronto, it's right downtown at the Air Canada Centre, no longer at Maple Leaf Gardens, but you can still feel the history. That's Stan Mikita, 1967. The Blackhawks were best team in the NHL, the Stanley Cup favorites, but the Maple Leafs beat them in six games in the first round of the playoffs en route to winning the Stanley Cup. That is the ring that the Blackhawks have put together for their organization after winning it last year. The Penguins one from 2009 was valued at about $28,000. I think this one beats it. And earlier today, that's the president, John McDonough, on the right, Bill Hay, the chairman of the Hockey Hall of Fame. The Blackhawks donated a ring in the name of Jonathan Toews to the Hockey Hall of Fame. Meanwhile, here in Toronto, all they want to do in this building is see some playoffs. It's been 6 years. Only Florida's drought is longer. Matt Sundin, the last playoff game here, Game 6, Philly, 2004. He scored to send it in overtime, but the fans here have learned to stomach defeat like this one. Jeremy Roenick, he scored in overtime. That one was the one that put Philadelphia through to the Stanley Cup semifinal. They lost in seven games to Tampa. All they want here is some playoff action.
Ladies and gentlemen, will you please rise, remove your hats, and welcome Michelle Madeira in the singing of our national anthems.
See, can you see by the dawn's early what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, oh, the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming.
Jim Houston, Craig Simpson, Glenn Healy, gentlemen.
Elliot, you have to go back 10 years to 2001 to find a Chicago-Toronto game that had meaning this late in the season. It's the 638th meeting of original six rivals, Chicago and Toronto. And you are a hockey psychic if you can tell me you saw this March goaltending matchup coming. 26-year-old Corey Crawford from Montreal makes his 11th consecutive start for the Blackhawks. He has 25 wins and is a Rookie of the Year candidate. James Reimer is just 10 days shy of his 23rd birthday. He makes his 10th straight start, and he hasn't lost in regulation in a month. Dean Morton and Kevin Pollock, the referees for this game tonight. Buffalo won today. Toronto needs a big victory. The Blackhawks stand in their way, and they've won 7 in a row and are fourth in the West. This game isn't about positioning, though. It's about disposition that will decide this game. Duncan Keith and Nick Leddy paired on defense at Chicago's top line, as Elliott mentioned, on the ice. Jonathan Taves and Patricks, Kane and Sharp. Dion Phaneuf and Keith Ollie out against the top line. Here's a 2-on-1. Kulman shoots, deflected up high by rookie Nick Leddy, and out of play.
Well, this matchup is going to be an intriguing one, and the one to watch is Duncan Keith, as he's so active up the ice trying to join the rush. It almost cost the Chicago Blackhawks early. Keith gets a little bit careless going in the offensive blue line, and he gets caught, and that creates the 2-on-1.
So a good chance to start for Toronto. We watch with interest to see if they'll wade into this game or go right at the Blackhawks. Hawks played last night, were very late coming in. Bill Kessel on the ice now. Tyler Bozak and Joffrey Lupo in off the blue line. Carl Gunnarsson paired with Luke Shen. David Boland second line up for Chicago with Marian Hossa on the right wing. Nicholas Jalmerson. Brent Seabrook, and he moves the puck ahead. Hossa can't find it. It was in his skates. Bozak coming back, got a hold of the puck, and now Phil Kessel moves in on Jalmerson. Passes off. Crawford makes his first big save as he kicked the puck out on a loophole shot. And Luke Shen is back to collect the puck in his own zone. Boland, Brian Bickle, and Marian Hossa, the forward line. There's a big turnover. Hossa shoots, scores! A giveaway and gift accepted by Marian Hossa. 1-0 Chicago.
Well, during this hot streak for the Toronto Maple Leafs, you haven't seen a whole lot of this. This is what's plagued them early in the year. Defense turning pucks over. A long pass by Gunnarsson, and he just looks right through Marian Hossa. Luke Shen there is just in the way. You either got to get down and get a piece of that or get out of the way for your goaltender, Glenn Healy.
Well, break that one down. I mean, that's up the middle. Wrong time to do it. Minute and 10 into the game, and you give it to a game breaker who is one of the most skilled guys on the Chicago Blackhawks. The one thing about Hossa, he doesn't have a hard shot, but he's got a very accurate shot. I talked to Marty Turco about that in warm-up, and there's the classic example. Right on the button. But Gunnarsson's got other options. I mean, that's not your first look right there.
So a good start for the Blackhawks, having won 7 in a row, and they're out on the road and have a 1-0 lead at 1:10. An unassisted goal by Marian Hossa. Brett Lebda up the boards. Third line's out here for Toronto. Colby Armstrong lifted the puck to center. He's with Joey Crabb and Darryl Boyce. Michael Frolik tipped the puck in deep, in forechecking Troy Brower. And Brett Lebda stops as Toronto changes. Already down the ice, Joey Crabb all tangled up with Chris Campoli 200 feet from where the puck was.
I don't see that too often. They got tied up with each other.
Thomas Kopetsky in front of his own net. Ryan Johnson back to Kopetsky, and he starts out. This fourth line for Chicago has been going pretty well thanks to Ryan Johnson. Late season pickup. Very experienced penalty killer, good centerman. He's wearing number 17 for the Blackhawks. Thunder Bay native gets the puck to Kopetsky. Ryan Campbell was up on the play, and now he's caught. Brown with a shot and a big rebound off Corey Crawford. Gunnarsson with a shot that deflected wide. Dion Phaneuf on the other side just holds the puck in for Brown to go after. Schustrom couldn't get it either. And Kopetsky for Chicago skates out to center and dumps the puck in against Keith Olin. Victor Stahlberg played 40 games for the Leafs last season, now a Blackhawk. He was in forechecking, but Toronto got to center. Jonathan Taves down on the ice as the top line for the Blackhawks comes back on for its second shift. Nick Leddy centering pass in the neutral zone, went off the skate. There's Clark MacArthur with Grabowski and Kulman head-to-head with this top line of Chicago's. 19-year-old Nick Leddy paired on defense here with Duncan Keith. There's a great pass by Keith. Patrick Kane, drop pass. Taves shoots. That got through, but just wide. Kane turns to the net, takes the shot, and Reimer makes the save and stops playing.
Guys, when you play the Chicago Blackhawks, you can talk matchup all you want, but the bottom line is that you have to forecheck against that defense. You talked about Simmer, Leddy, and Keith, and the reason you've got to do that is you've got to play in their end. If you don't play in their end, you're going to play with the Globetrotters in the other end, and they are just too good not to get chances.
Dave Bolin with a face-off win, and Brent Seabrook in an attempt to keep the puck in had it deflect out of play.
And Simmer, is that not what you see from Chicago? They've got three lines of play so good offensively that you defend so often that when you finally do get the puck, you got no gas to go and play on the offensive side of the game.
Well, and they jump on you early. You look at what they've done in the first period. It's been their best. It's been the problem for Toronto all year long, not being able to score first. The one thing the Leafs have done a better job of, they've shaken off the bad start and shaken off a goal against and got right back to their game plan of getting pucks deep and turning pucks over.
And James Reimer's been excellent at shaking off the bad goal and refocusing. Gunnarsson took a hit, but he made the play to center. Seabrook, formerly Duncan Keith's regular partner, now paired with Nick Chalmerson. And they're out against Phil Kessel, Tyler Bozak, and Joffrey Lupul. And Kessel has to chase the puck into his own zone as Chicago changes on the fly. He'll pick up some speed as he skates to center. Got by Troy Brouwer, lost the puck. Lupul got it. His pass off a skate. It's a two-on-one the other way. Brouwer, Frolik, shoots, scores! Newcomer Michael Frolik with his second goal as a Hawk, and it's a 2-0 Blackhawk lead.
Well, it's the turnover parade that hurts the Leafs once again. This time, it's Lupul at the blue line. The one thing you can't do, everybody's committed to the rush. Kessel tries to beat a man one-on-one, loses it, goes right to Lupul, and he tries to force it through the middle. The middle has been what Chicago's been able to gobble up. Once again, Komisarek down, but the defense not getting over to block that shot. Not many options. He took away the passing option, and that's one for Reimer back deep in his net, and that one simply goes through him.
Brouwer and Jake Dowell get assists on the goal at 4:13. I wondered if Ron Wilson might have even considered a timeout there after that second goal. He didn't, and play continues. Frolik went 32 games without a goal. Now he's got a pair as a Blackhawk.
I think the Toronto Maple Leafs, it's got to be like when you play pool. It's not what you make, it's what you leave. And both of those goals, the Maple Leafs have shot themselves in the foot. I mean, you've got Lebda almost leading the rush over the blue line. That's not the time when you're going to take a chance.
Blackhawks won the draw. Campbell with his shot that was blocked, didn't get through. He's got the puck again and leaves it along the boards. Ryan Johnson, Kopetsky, with Stahlberg cycling the puck. And Dion Phaneuf breaks the cycle. Joey Crabbe clears the puck down the ice. Campbell cruises back to get it. No icing. Leafs have made a change. Their fourth line centered by Tim Brent on the ice. Campbell dumps the puck in and heads off for a change. Gunnarsson is back. Bumped by Ryan Johnson. And the Leafs get out to center. Tim Brent with Frederick Schuster. A little chip in. Nick Reddy is back. He takes Schusterman, and Patrick Sharp comes back for the puck. Hawks changing to get their top line on here against the fourth line of the Toronto Maple Leafs, and there's an icing call against Chicago. Let's bring in Elliot.
As Reimer mentioned, Andy Nowicki is goaltending coach in Red Deer. He taught him the five R's. Whenever you give up a goal, review, release your negative energy, reload, refocus, and have relentless energy. Those are the things he's supposed to do whenever he gives up one. He's had two to review so far, Jim.
He's got a little R and R going right now.
Absolutely.
I'll add another one. Respond.
His teammates will look after that. I loved what he said in the interview with Elliot about his demeanor, reflecting the demeanor of the team. Here's Sharp with a backhand shot wide of the net. This is way too wide open, and the Blackhawks love it. Keith Allen, his pass up the middle. Chalmerson tried to make a pass. Grabowski had the puck and lost it. Taves, here's Kane, tried to make a move. MacArthur came back and snatched the puck, and he starts out. Might be a 3-on-2, but Kuhlman changes. Grabowski, MacArthur on Seabrook. Looking for a trailer on the play, and can't find one. From the blue line, Shen with a shot that's wide. Chalmerson's after the puck. Kessel got there first. And the Blackhawks are able to clear the puck, not spending much time in their own end of the rink. Luke Shen paired with Carl Gunnarsson. Kessel line on with Lupul and Bozak. Ryan Bickle to Dave Bolin. He's got Hossa with him, streaking to the net. There's the pass. Didn't get through. Gunnarsson calmly made the play to Shen. And the Leafs get out of their own zone.
And you can see early on here, it's going to be important for the Leafs to try to shut the speed of the Hawks down in the neutral zone. They're getting far too much going through.
There's Boland, and he can't tuck the puck by Reimer, and a terrific dish from Hossa. Darian Hossa to Duncan Keith on the other side. Hossa kicked the puck to Nicoletti. Boland with Bickle in front. Pass comes back to Letty. Looks like a Chicago power play. Marian Hossa into traffic. Look how strong he is as he gets the puck to the boards and then keeps it in against a couple of Leafs. Former Ottawa 67 Brian Bickle can't hold the puck in, and the Leafs clear it, and now they have to change.
And you talk about respond. This is the kind of shift for the Leafs that they got to quit chasing. They got to try to start hitting some bodies, slow the Hawks down, and get the puck in the offensive zone.
Letty winding into the attacking zone. Lost the puck, but his teammates get it back for him. Jake Dowell trying to come up with it with Troy Brower here and Michael Foley. Here's Dowell. Handled by Komisarek. And the puck squirts loose to Reimer, and he covers up. Marian Hossa at a minute 10. Michael Foley at 4:13. 2-0 Hawks on Hockey Night.
Montreal starts tonight, six back of the Bruins. They score early in Tampa. Hal Gill's second of the year from Gionta and Plekanec. Jim Craig and Glenn.
Marian Hossa has scored six goals in his last seven games. Might be as complete a player as there is in the NHL.
And he's getting hot at the right time. I mean, he does so many things well. He's got such composure. Look at bad pass, just kicks it back like a good soccer player. And then look at the strength in traffic. He's able to handle the puck. He fought off two Leafs later on in that shift, and no panic, got the puck deep.
Just leaned on his stick. There's a loose puck in front, and Reimer has to make a big save there off Troy Brower. As Chicago really controls, Campbell to Dowell, bouncing puck side of the net, the Leafs collapse to the goal. Well, pushed off the puck was Darryl Boyce, but he recovers to get the puck to center. Leafs better be careful, this will be out of hand in no time. Tab to Boyce up the middle, and Corey Crawford reaches out and snatches the puck out of the air as Campoli and Armstrong mix it up.
One thing Ron Wilson was talking about this morning was the overall team speed of the Chicago Blackhawks, and early on, you've seen it really on display. They've had trouble slowing them down. Here's what's happened with the Leafs, though. Even despite the incredible record that they've had in their last 16 games, look at the goals for and against in the power play. Still just not much margin for error. The power play hasn't been on track, but they've been finding ways to grind out wins. 8-0-3 in one-goal games in their last 11.
Remarkably, they won in Philadelphia the other night, went 0-for-7 on the power play as MacArthur is stopped by Corey Crawford. Leafs get another chance, and they've had two or three of them early in the game as the puck went over the blue line and is offside.
Well, both teams have really passed the torch of their rookie goaltenders. Believe it or not, 26 years old, Crawford is a rookie. And you look back to last year, they had a choice between Niemi and Crawford. Both were equal in the way they had played. Well, Crawford didn't have to clear waivers, Niemi did, so guess what? Have a good time in the minors. Now he's come back up, and he has really taken hold of the starting job. Now, Niemi did win the Stanley Cup and is starting in San Jose, but that's a pretty darn good goaltender. Early in his career, Simmer, the book on him was lots of rebounds, and he doesn't get east to west very quick. I'm not seeing that tonight or through this year.
He had to bide his time since being drafted in 03. That was the year Marc-Andre Fleury was a pretty good goaltender, drafted by Pittsburgh. And from 05 until this season, he was in the minors. Corey Crawford has a 2-0 lead here.
What a difference that makes, though, isn't it? 255 games in the minors, 135 wins. This isn't new for him. He's used to carrying the load for a team. It's just at a different level.
Kane to Sharp. What a pass. He spins, and he coughed up the puck trying to get it to Jonathan Toews. Nicoletti. There's Patrick Kane. Shoots the puck in, completes a line change. Blackhawks using four lines and quick shifts here early in the game after playing at home last night. Here's Joffrey Lupo. Nice stick there by 19-year-old Nicoletti. Brian Bickle from Orono, Ontario.
Isn't that where you're from, Hill?
Ajax, but that's okay. Close enough. I tell you what, Bickle can skate fast enough to get to Ajax. That guy's got great speed.
Big guy, too.
Yeah.
Joffrey Lupo trying a shot here. Slashed at. There's a penalty being called. And it'll be Joffrey Lupo getting a slashing penalty. He Ajax Knights are this week's winners of the Scotiabank Kids Contest on Scotiabank Hockey Tonight. The Knights are headed to Peterborough for the Lakeshore Championship after finishing off Oshawa in the semis.
Well, here's the bad news for the Leafs. Down by two, Leupel coming back in the offensive zone, loses the puck and just smacks the stick of Letty, broke it in half. And the top power play in the National Hockey League goes back to work.
Led by Patrick Sharp with a dozen power play goals, and he plays at the left point. Brent Seabrook is now on the first unit power play on the right side, and the puck is out of the park. And is that going to be 5-on-3?
It is.
Uh-oh,
from bad to worse.
There's two of the toughest penalties in the league right now, a slash of a stick and over the glass.
Jim, it never fails, doesn't it, though? When you get a questionable first call, it always seems to bite you that this is the second call that ends up happening. And Tim Brent just turned and fired and aimlessly gets it up and over. Watch the quick puck movement here by the Chicago Blackhawks. They'll try to get one timer out of Sharp or Kane on the other side.
Taves starts it off with a faceoff win. Seabrook starts to move in with Sharp. Side of the net. Kane right in front. Schreiber made a nice save there, and the rebound is cleared. Carl Gunnarsson, Luke Shen, two defensemen, and Tyler Bozak. The only forward out of the penalty kill as the 5-on-3 moves in again, and it could be a long one. Sharp wants to set up. As Seabrook with it, side of the net, a return pass for Patrick Sharp. Wasn't expecting it, kept the play alive. Side of the net, Bolin to Taves. Bolin again, a little back pass, kicked it back to Seabrook. He shoots, deflected wide. Patrick Kane, watched by Luke Shen. Seabrook, Kane, Bolin, side of the net, stops the puck, fed it over to Taves. It was in the air, couldn't knock it out. And the puck is hung up in the equipment of Patrick Kane.
Oh, what a break for the Leafs there. It's going to come outside because Kane couldn't get it out of his pants. But there's the quick puck movement. Instead of getting the shot up high, they go down low. A little saucer pass and a good stick there coming across by Gunnarsson that got that a little bit of a deflection. It was trying to go tape to tape to Taves on the side, and you could see it hit him right in the shin.
You can see 5-on-4, Kopecky goes out, plays the net front presence. 5-on-3 comes off, and it's Bolin on the one-timer. You think about this power play. You don't even have Hossa on the ice.
That is
that's
amazing.
That's
isn't
amazing,
it?
You know.
Nor Duncan Keith.
World-class player with exceptional skill. Maybe next time. He'll be on the second unit, son.
Keith and Hossa will come in the second wave if they get a chance. Still almost a minute of 5-on-3 time here, and the penalty killers get a needed change. Bozak, Shin, and Gunnarsson, after a brief rest, come right back on.
Hossa had his leg up over the bench. He wanted to get on. Nobody came off.
These guys aren't volunteering to get off the ice,
they
are they?
Had the blinders on.
Seabrook. Here's Patrick Sharp. Seabrook. Taves screening. Sharp shoots. Climber the save. Bolin can't deal with the rebound. It's in the air, and he's trying to pass it back to the point, and he does. Patrick Sharp. Brent Seabrook. Taves parks in front. Bolin side of the net. So is Patrick Kane, and he has the puck. Turns. Kane to Sharp. How did that stay out? Looked like Reimer got a piece of it, and Lupo's out of the penalty box. And the puck comes right to him. And he gets in over the blue line offside with 4 seconds to go in the penalty to Tim Brent. And the Leafs are just about through this.
Yeah, if ever you can get some motivation out of a penalty kill, this is it. This is really the best shot that they had in this whole 5-on-3, and it's from outside the dots. If you're going to give up anything, rather be giving up a one-timer that far out. Reimer read it well, got across, and there's Marian Hossa with 4 seconds left on a power play. Not too happy.
4 seconds of power play time for Duncan Keith, the Norris Trophy winner, and Marian Hossa.
That's why he never gets out. He didn't do anything there. Now we're back to full strength.
5-on-5 again.
Zimmer, you make a good point. That could have been the game right there. Now the Leafs are one shot away from being in this versus being right out of it.
Fans trying to get their team into it here. Nick Leddy. Duncan Keith on his offside. Shoots the puck in. Pickle goes in after. There's Marian Hossa. He's bumped hard by Dion Phaneuf. And the puck is cleared by Mikhail Grabowski to center. Toronto is changing as Kessel goes in after Leddy. Duncan Keith, Ryan Johnson at center as the fourth line for Chicago comes on here. Here's Brett Lebda. Thomas Eric with him as he moves to center, and the Hawks back off in the neutral zone. Thomas Eric to Kessel, and he dumps the puck in. Crawford out to set it up. Ryan Campbell to Troy Brower. Thomas Eric sends the puck back the other way. Here's Joffrey Lupul. He's got Kessel with him and gives him the puck. Taves tries to check him. A nice shot and a good save by Crawford. And the puck is cleared over the glass. And now Chicago will be penalized. So the Toronto Maple Leafs get a power play, trailing 2-0 on Hockey Night in Canada on CBC.
Our Subway restaurant biosubject has a brother, Keith, in the AHL. We asked Keith today, what don't we know about Brent?
Well, I think away from the rink, he's one of the bigger teddy bears out there. I think he's a little intimidating on the ice, but, out of the rink, I think he's just a big teddy bear, that guy.
They won't want him to be a teddy bear now on the penalty kill, Jim.
Funny, in describing Brent Seabrook, I never thought of that.
No, it didn't come to mind.
I wouldn't hire his brother as a scout, I can tell you that.
Teddy Bear just after the puck, but he couldn't clear it. Toronto's on the power play, 0-7 in Philadelphia on Thursday night, but it was a pretty darn good 0-7. They controlled the puck, they just didn't score. Had 10 power play shots. Dion Phaneuf with Tim Brent over at the left point. Tyler Bozak walks in and he passed to Kessel off the heel of his stick on the one-timer. Joffrey Lupul up front on a set line in the power play as well. Kessel turns to the net, passes off. Lupul trying to jam it in, and Corey Crawford makes the save.
That was just a positional save for Crawford. That quick puck movement. When Kessel attacks the lane, the goaltender's forced to be wary of the shot. You could see how quickly he got to the post, and the glove was just in the right place at the right time as Lupul almost put it by him.
Did you think Tyler Bozak should have shot the puck?
Yeah, absolutely.
Bozak, Toronto's best faceoff man, won the draw, but Jonathan Toews clears the puck. He does everything. He plays in the power play. He's out killing the penalty. MVP candidate Jonathan Toews, number 19. As the Leafs come up the middle to tip it. Duncan Keith swiftly back for the puck. And his partner Chris Campoli. And down the ice, Dion Phaneuf has to regroup. Power play's changing up. Hrabowski's line is coming on for Toronto. Phaneuf with a hard shoot in. Leafs overload the left wing. Hrabowski trying to come up with the puck. Tim Brent down to get it. Kuhlman kicks back to the blue line in Brent's spot. Now he has the puck. Here's Brent. There was a screen. Now Dion Phaneuf can't get the shot through, so he passes off. Brent to MacArthur. Hooked it towards the net. Loose puck after being knocked down is cleared by Chris Campoli.
One thing right now, when you're not scoring, like as you mentioned, 0-7, you have to establish a shot. And right now, you don't have a body in front of Crawford. He's seen the puck, and nothing's getting through.
Mark MacArthur had his feet taken off from under him by Nicholas Hjalmarsson. And the puck is cleared back down the ice, and it'll just about do it. One last rush for the Toronto power play as Brett Lebda is back to pick up the puck. On the fly, Colby Armstrong stops up to set it. Carl Gunnarsson, penalty's over. There's the shot knocked down. Taves has the puck. Campbell sprinted out of the penalty box and wanted the puck and then heads to the bench when he didn't get it. Lebda out of his own zone, tipped at center by Armstrong, and it'll go the distance. Keith is back for the puck. Darryl Boyce flushes him out, so he plays the puck up the boards. Keith Ollie is there to shoot it back in for Toronto. The Leafs have settled down now, not giving up as many chances, but they're down 2-0. Two goals in the first 4 minutes and 13 seconds of the game. Here's Patrick Kane, side of the net, score! Jonathan Toews for Patrick Kane, 3-0 Chicago.
Well, Jim, I mentioned earlier the neutral zone is just killing the Toronto Maple Leafs right now. And there's just far too much room. Watch this precision passing, a little short support pass, another one by Toews, Hossa, and then on their off wing, they're so valuable. Kane is able to cut to the middle. He has to threat shot. Toews slips through Bozak there, goes right to the net, stick on the ice. And because they're on their off wings on the outside, Patrick Kane just has such great vision of the ice and makes a perfect pass to the captain, who stays hot again.
Hottest line in the league. Toews from Hossa and Kane at 15:37. 3-0 Hawks. Ryan Campbell hit hard and knocked down.
Having played on the offside. side as a winger. I can tell you, it's just you have so many options. And Patrick Kane has that ability to threaten shot. If you're a goaltender and he's coming down that right side, you have to respect the threat of the shot. So you get frozen for a second. As he freezes, he makes that perfect pass cross ice to an empty net for Taves.
I think the Maple Leafs are just having a hard time keeping up with the ability of Chicago to pass the puck. I mean, real speed is puck movement. You can never keep up to the puck. And so these 50 and 80 foot passes, good luck. You're in between all night.
Hawks playing a string of games against the East. They're 7-3 against the Eastern Conference. And the West overall is 57 wins above 500 against the Eastern Conference this season. Thomas Kopetsky. Four-line game, and it really sets up to be a four-line game for Chicago now with a 3-0 first period lead. Brett Lebda lifted the puck out of his own zone. Seabrook. Chalmerson. And back on a Chicago change. Pinpoint pass up the middle. Stahlberg tried to dump the puck in. Kuhlman had Stahlberg take the puck away. Now Nikolai Kuhlman gets out of his own zone. Fredrik Sjostrom after the puck. Duncan Keith has it. A reverse for Leddy. Dave Bolin out of his own zone. His pass to Marian Hossa. Left it along the boards for Keith. And Mike Brown came over and got a piece of him, trying to send Bozak away against the rookie Leddy. Bozak for Brown. Leddy broke the play up. Beating out his partner Duncan Keith, who just gets back now.
Oh, that hurt Keith. That was a heck of a hit by Brown.
He's a solid guy.
You saw the ability of Keith to jump off ice there.
There's another giveaway. Bickle couldn't make Toronto pay this time.
I mean, it's just a treat to watch the Norris Trophy winner. He makes the play in his own zone, and then just like a rocket goes right past Sjostrom and joins the play there. But that's one way to stop the speed, a big hit.
Here comes Kane again on that off wing to tip Jonathan Toews. Perfect shot, couldn't bury it. The line just about had another one. And there's a Toronto penalty coming up on the play as the Hawks are just too much for the Leafs to handle in this first period. Mike Brown on Duncan Keith. Hawks lead 3-0. Keith Holley takes the hooking penalty at 18-17.
Globetrotters are in town, and the Leafs are having a hard time keeping up with the speed. That last shift, it's amazing. Taves desperately needed his skate sharpened. And it didn't take a skate off. He got it done by a portable skate sharpener on the bench. He killed two shifts shorthanded and then stepped on the ice for his third shift to put it in the back of the net for the 3-0 goal. Technology is amazing, and most of the teams in the NHL are using that now. For that reason, you don't have to take the boot off and wait the 8 minutes for the trainer to get it done.
So Taves is at 6 minutes and 50 seconds already in this period, and he's on the ice again, having scored his 27th of the season, and the Blackhawk power play comes to center. And Thomas Kopetsky out on the ice in his power play, and no Marian Hossa on this unit either. Patrick Sharp at the blue line holds the puck in. Here's Brent Seabrook. Jonathan Taves. Patrick Kane, and watched by Gunnarsson and chased to the blue line. Kopetsky parked in front of the net. Here's Taves, and he just about set up Patrick Sharp. For Sharp, that's a couple that he's missed. Tap-ins at the side of the net.
Yeah, and he's frustrated. You think about what a year he's having. He's been all around the net, and he's perched on that off wing. Another perfect example of the right-hander on that left side, and he just couldn't get a hold of that one earlier on that penalty. He had a wide open net that he missed as well.
Olin got the draw, tipped the puck through to Duncan Keith in the second power play unit. There's Marian Hossa. The Duncan Keith, Hossa heads for the front of the net. Troy Brower at the side of the goal as Campbell gets the puck to him, and he couldn't scoop it to the front of the net. Dion Futa hammered the puck around on the boards, and he gets it down the ice in the last 30 seconds of this first period. Shots are 9-7 Chicago. They lead 3-0. Campbell tips the puck in. Brower goes after Gunnarsson. Bozak, this little play off the boards. Luke Chen trying to clear the puck. Duncan Keith can't hold it in. Bozak and Armstrong try and get away and couldn't. In comes Brower. Dave Bolin shoots it. That was blocked by Luke Shin. And the period comes to an end, and this penalty to Keith Ollie will carry over into the second period for 17 seconds. Hawks, winners of seven in a row, have a 3-0 lead on goals by Hossa, Frolik, and Jonathan Toews. Coming up in our first intermission on Hockey Night in Canada, it's Don Cherry, Ron McLean, and the Coach's Corner. Hockey Night in Canada continues on CBC.
3-0 Chicago after one period downtown Toronto here at the Air Canada Centre. Watch the game in 360 with the Hockey Night All-Access Camera presented by Chevrolet. Log on to cbcsports.ca and control your own live camera. Check out action away from the player on the bench with the Chevrolet All-Access Cam. Typical coaches, guys. I had a chance to talk to Mike Kitchen in the intermission. Said there can't be too much you disliked in that first period. He immediately said power play. For all the talent we have on that, we could have done a lot better. Said against Toronto, you know they like to pinch their D, Jim. So if you keep the puck behind them, you're going to get your chances.
Picky, picky. You know, it is hard to imagine when you watch a first period like Chicago had that they are only 3 points up on the ninth place team in the Western Conference. And not out of the woods yet. They're rolling tonight. Led by Jonathan Toews, who now has points in 9 consecutive games. And the Leafs needed a little visit to the Adjustment Bureau as they begin the second period, now back to 5-on-5. There's a chip just wide of the net by Joey Crabb. Mark MacArthur with Grabowski, Nikolai Kuhlman. Again, playing head-to-head with his Toews line. Grabowski tried a centering pass, picked off by Sharp. He couldn't get out. Mike Komisarek held the puck in. Mark MacArthur pinned by Nick Leddy. Toews in to help out. The centering pass is gobbled up by Duncan Keith. And Patrick Sharp gets out to center to Patrick Kane. Keith jumps up on the play. Standing up in the neutral zone is Mike Komisarek. Puck comes to Kane when he's headed for the bench. Nikolai Kuhlman back to get the puck. Toronto wants to start a change here. Dion Phaneuf to center. Turned back by Dave Boland and Brian Bickle. Komisarek can't get off the ice on a change. Boland into the middle. And Dion Phaneuf poked the puck away from Marian Hossa. Hossa stays up ice, and aerial Keith Ollie goes back after it. Brian Bickle in forechecking. Komisarek still out there. And Phil Kessel gets the puck out of his own zone. Nick Hjalmarsson to Brent Seabrook, and up the middle, a tip in by Boland from his own side of center, and an icing call against Chicago.
Be clear about how to invest better with BMO Smart Steps for Investing. BMO Bank of Montreal. Making money make sense.
Marian Hossa had some time injured. The team has been out of sync. They seem to be firing on all cylinders right now, though, with 7 consecutive victories. But it took them a while to get to this point. For the Blackhawks, look like Stanley Cup champs now, don't they?
They absolutely do. And you have 8 players right now with streaks going on, and none of them more streaky than this three. When your top players are playing at the level that Kane, Toews, and Sharp are, everybody follows suit. And as everyone's talked about, the goaltending's been fantastic. And all of a sudden, this team that seemed out of sorts, that had all kinds of new bodies as the defending Stanley Cup champs, they're looking a lot like the Cup champions.
Well, they made the West a very interesting place. Along with San Jose, the Sharks have been on a real roll, and it looked like a two-team Western Conference with Vancouver and Detroit ahead of everybody for a while.
Well, early on in the year, guys, they lost 13 games where they were leading or tied late in the hockey game. And that's just the Stanley Cup hangover. I lived in New York in 94. We made the playoffs the second last game of the season with a great squad. And you spend a couple months partying, enjoying yourself, you've earned it, and it took a long time for guys to get back on track.
Well, I tell you, Heels, they're lucky that Jonathan Toews decided to leave the party early. Here's a chance for Bozak, and a shot is stopped by Corey Crawford. That could have been huge.
Now, what a great second effort by Crawford, just staying up high enough.
Stallberg can fly, and he shot the puck just wide of the net, occupied by James Reimer. Too many men on the ice here. And a penalty coming up against the Blackhawks.
this game can change. I mean, there's the old saying, a 3-0 first period lead, worst lead in hockey, and Joel Quenneville knows it. You can't take your foot off the gas. A bouncing puck, nice effort by Bozak, but watch Crawford. See how he kept his pad stacked, and he just stayed up as long as he could and tried to outweigh Bozak. And on the ensuing play, that long shot by Stahlberg went wide and went around, and unfortunately for the Hawks, they're in the middle of making a change, and the player who came on played it too quickly.
Two mistakes made there. Chicago turned it over at the Leafs' blue line, and then the too many men on the ice. So they've created their problems here for two or less.
Here's Dion Phaneuf with a power play shot that's blocked, and Dave Bolin gets the puck out over the blue line against Kuhlman. Following him is Ryan Johnson. Takes the puck deep, kills some time, and heads to the bench on a Chicago change. And the power play starts out to center. On the fly is Kuhlman. Grabowski in front. What a good stick by Duncan Keith to tip the puck away to the corner. Phaneuf holds the puck in, then a bad pass to MacArthur. Gets into the corner, and Duncan Keith has the puck. Taken away by Kuhlman. Mark MacArthur and Grabowski work along the boards, but Hossa got the puck to Jonathan Toews. He's got Seabrook with him, but he couldn't get him the puck. This is one of the teams, there are a few teams now in the NHL where the top players kill penalties. Toews and Hossa on the ice.
When you get into a long playoff round, though, it is a scenario that could end up hurting them, though. And when you get a bunch of penalties against and then go a bunch of power plays, your top players are just out of gas.
That's why Ryan Johnson's a pretty good pickup.
Yeah, absolutely.
Take some minutes at center ice away on the penalty kill.
Now you look at Hossa and Toews, and now Sharp out with Bickle. There's your three out of your top six right there.
Leafs' Brett Lebda winds up, passes off. There's a shot that's blocked and sent to the boards as Phil Kessel wound up with a big shot and ended up on the ice.
Great thing about Johnson as well, too, guys, his face-off prowess. 74% against Carolina in the past four games, 72%. So kill a penalty, start with the puck. You don't have to kill as much in your own end.
And Reimer's forced to hold on to the puck with 11 seconds to go in the Chicago penalty, and his power play 0 for its last 17 is having trouble.
This has been a real reality check for the Maple Leafs, and I think what they found here with Chicago is Chicago Stanley Cup champs because they have the ability to sparkle and shine. I mean, the execution, the ability to pass the puck, tape to tape, to clear their zone, one, two passes, and all of a sudden they're in your zone. I mean, I've mentioned it in the first, it's been Globetrotter-like, but been a real eye-opener for the Maple Leafs.
And it is remarkable. It says a lot about the race in the Western Conference that they could have a bad week and still be out of the playoff picture.
I think that's why you see Crawford in the golden. I think a lot of people were wondering whether Marty Turco would take the game tonight. But I think for Joel Quenneville, you've won seven in a row. You're red hot. Kids playing fantastic. You just can't afford to lose the points.
And he's been waiting in the minors for 5 years for his chance to play. I don't think he wants a night off.
No.
Colby Armstrong with the shoot-in. Teams are 5-on-5 again. Leafs 0 for 2 on the power play. Brent Seabrook, watched by Joey Crabb. Hard pass up the middle. Kane deflected the puck, but he can't find it. And Patrick Kane, had he spotted the puck as fast enough, he would have got to it.
Yeah, you know, he looked to his left. He knew that it was tipped, but he looked to his left. Instead, it went right over his head. Otherwise, he would have had it. And watch what he tries to do here. He takes off quickly. And he tries to just chip it up over Gunnarsson. And you can see how close that was to getting there. You just can't take your eyes off of 88. He'll try to slip behind the defense every chance he can. As soon as that puck was turned over, he was gone.
Tim Brent won the faceoff. Toronto's going to try and break out. Brown went back the other way. Komisarek, Gunnarsson paired together here now.
Guys, is there a more mobile defense in the Chicago Blackhawks? Campbell, Campoli, Keith, Seabrook, Letty, Charmelson. I mean, they're all can skate. They're all puck movers.
That's why those big rebounds don't cause many problems. There aren't many second chances around Corey Crawford's net. Puck is out of play with 13:57 to go in the second period. 3-0 Hawks on Hockey Night in Canada. Two very experienced coaches, Joel Quenneville and Ron Wilson, were teammates as defensemen with the Leafs in the late 70s.
Different intensity level on bench changes from both coaches. Look at Wilson. Hardly says a word. Quenneville, every time there's a change on the bench, he is barking at his players to drive the level of intensity up. He knows the importance of the game. And when I'm between the benches, guys, there is a difference in the way the two teams change. Toronto has got to go above 98.6, and Chicago seems to have much more of an intensity level in the way they change and their urgency level.
Hrabowski line out for Toronto right now. And there's a pass that was tipped out of play.
Right now, you talk intensity. The Leafs need a spark. And at times, if you're not going to get the goal, Glenn talked about the fact that the defense is so mobile for the Chicago Blackhawks that it's hard to get them pinned in. I think the Leafs right now need to dump that puck in softly in a cross corner, force that D to have their face against the glass, digging for the puck. If it comes around, they're just so mobile and able to get it out easily.
Leafs in trouble again. Hossa got the puck to Bickle, and he couldn't get it in front for David Bolin. Hrabowski to center for Kuhlman, knocked away by Brent Seabrook.
That's what you can't do there, the turnovers at the offensive line. The transition game is so dangerous. We've seen it already in this game twice.
Danault stole the puck with a give and go play, and he didn't get the puck back. It was tipped. Marion Hossa clears the puck to center. Bolin rushes onto it up against Keith Holley. Bickle got a piece of Hrabowski. Ends up with the puck. Mark MacArthur in on Chalmers. He gets hammered into the boards, but he got the puck to Seabrook. He couldn't get it out. He'll get another chance. Hossa to Chalmers. He gets to center and dumps the puck in as his teammates start a chain.
There's another great example of it there. Good hit on Jalmerson, but then three quick passes and the Chicago Blackhawks walk out of the zone.
There's Patrick Kane. Sharps in front of the net. So is Jonathan Taves. Kane with a little pass to the blue line. And Lupo got to that before Duncan Keith. Lupo stole it away. Here he goes to the net. Scores! Toronto needed that in the worst way. Joffrey Lupo gets the goal. It's a 3-1 game.
Jim, it's interesting. A young player like Letty playing the right side defense as a left-handed shot. For the most part, you can be protected. But this type of play, he opens himself up, tries to get it across to Keith, and then a great effort of driving to the net by Joffrey Lupo. But a very difficult play. If he's a right-handed shot like most right D, just goes up the wall and is able to make an easy play. Instead, it ends up in the back of the net.
It's how you see the ice, right? You're playing your offside. First look is to the middle instead of the safe play up the boards with a 3-0 game.
Don't you think the whole problem started with Patrick Kane's little dish at the blue line to Keith, an ill-advised pass?
Well, it's one of those that great players offensively think they can make any kind of play. And he, right here, he's trying to get a one-timer there. And a good aggressive play by Lupo. There's the turnover. As the goaltender, good speed. I like the fact that he attacked the net. Too often, guys will try to go around and just take a shot. Instead, he made an inside power move and got it up and over.
Well, can they build on that? Toronto's within two. Joffrey Lupo gets the crowd back into it. Stahlberg, Johnson, and Kopetsky out here. Fourth line shift for Chicago. Here's Brian Campbell. Fires a shot, and Reimer makes the save. And he'll hang on with some jostling in front.
Well, I mentioned half jokingly that 3-0 lead is a bad one. And the only reason is you look at the way that Chicago executed in the first period. They did everything right. They had jump, they had speed, they had great puck movement. And you go in between periods and you just can't help but relax a little bit. That 3-0 cushion just feels like you've got the game won. Now all of a sudden it's a 2-goal game and you got a spark on the other team. Can you get yourself back up? Can you ramp up the energy again? And a lot of times, teams have trouble with that 3-goal lead.
See the top scorers in the league since the 1st of January when Kane and Taves really started to crank it up. Their big month has been February. Here's Phil Kessel with Boyce and Lupo, and the shot on goal is stopped by Crawford. The Leafs have juggled some lines here and introduced some emotion into the game.
3 games and 4 nights for the Chicago Blackhawks, the late night. So Simmer, you mentioned it, little soft dump. And our last CBC poll was that there is only one defenseman in Chicago that would like to get hit. And it's not him, and it's not Campbell, and it's not Campoli.
So exactly right. That should be the key. Soft dumps and start laying some bodies, make it difficult, and get some turnovers. And that's exactly the game plan on the last shift, and it led to a goal with some momentum.
Chalmerson's out there again, but you could tell when he was sitting on the bench, that hurt him.
Yeah.
I mean, Seabrook may be the only guy that wants you to hit him because he's such a physical defenseman, unlike what his brother thinks.
And Duncan Keith just tried to hit him. I mean,
yeah,
we saw Brown hit him, but that was in the offensive zone. He was thinking offense. When he's back defensively, he's so elusive.
I'd like to remind you not to miss the 31st annual Genie Awards hosted by William Shatner, featuring performances by Melissa Etheridge, Serena Ryder, and more. That's Thursday night at 8 on CBC TV. Chalmerson won't get hit this time. Kuhlman couldn't get to him before he moved the puck. And Hossa will start out with David Boland and Ryan Pickle. The shoot in. Shen is the first man back. MacArthur tipped the puck off the boards to Kropovsky. And he'll need some help to get out to center. Kuhlman to Kropovsky. Drives wide on Seabrook. Cuts into the middle. Stopped by Crawford as his little backhander got to the net. Seabrook trying to clear the puck. Kropovsky. There again. Kuhlman's one-timer. He fanned on it. Didn't get much on it, and Crawford covers up.
Well, not often will you see Seabrook get beat that badly, but Grabowski has some little outside move. Watch Seabrook. He fights. As soon as he moves his feet, Grabowski goes inside. And we've talked about Marian Hossa a lot. Watch this ability to move the puck, kick it up, and keep it alive. I mean, just that hand-eye coordination and keeps his legs moving.
Leaps off the draw. Brown got a shot, and Crawford made the save as Toronto's really picked its game up. And Chicago needs a big shift to turn it around, so they have the Taves line on right now. Up against the Tim Glick centered fourth line. Schustrom's in after the puck. Brown's in front of the net. Keith steps in to break up the cycle. Nicoletti. Brown tried to get a lick in at him. Kane can't get the puck out of his own zone. Good hard work here by this Brent line for Toronto. Brown to the net. Stopped by Corey Crawford, and the rebound was there for a moment, too. Ollie with a shot. Duncan Keith steered that away. Schustrom, Brent, and Brown finish up the shift. Here's Keith Ollie. His shot stopped by Crawford. Letty. Good Duncan Keith. And the Hawks are in some trouble. What a change in the game.
Yeah, it's two hits, like Glenn said earlier. A couple of hits down low. Good hard forecheck. Kane loses the puck inside the line, and that creates this momentum.
And he lost that puck because of the threat of a hit. Troy Brower, centering pass. Frolik couldn't get a good shot away. Here's Brian Campbell. Drops the puck up. Michael Frolik with a shot, and James Reimer, who knows he's got no margin for error now, covers up the puck. Halfway through the second period, 3-1 Hawks on Hockey Night in Canada.
At the St. Pete Times Forum, Dominic Moore has a knack on Saturday nights. His 12th goal of the year from Kabina and Purcell at 1:25 into the second. It's 2-1 now, the Canadiens lead.
3-1 here, Chicago in the lead with Corey Crawford in goal. Glenn.
Maybe a Calder-type year, but he doesn't play the puck. Here, he should play it for Letty, insulate his defense. Instead, his defense gets smoked, momentum comes on, and he is forced to make three big saves. So, message to the Leafs, get it deep and create that forecheck, because this goaltender doesn't skate well enough to play the puck.
Toronto's really picked it up. They've started to win faceoffs. They're playing in the attacking zone. Looks like Tyler Bozak has been parked on the bench. Grabowski double shifts with Phil Kessel and Joffrey Lupo on this line. Malik, Jake Dowell, and Troy Brower in for Chicago. Here's Joffrey Lupo. Turn back, Mike Komisarek. Lupo makes a nice play, shielding the puck with his body, and Lebdick gets out to center. Phil Kessel on Campoli. Ryan Campbell back for the puck to Campoli, and up the boards, pinching in is Dion Phaneuf, but he couldn't get to the puck. Brett Lebda. Defensive pairs have been switched up, a little bit of line juggling. And Toronto within two. They've outshot Chicago 15-12. The tip in by Kopetsky is Ollie got a piece of him. Stahlberg. Bumped by Dion Phaneuf. Kopetsky, his pass to the point is deflected, and Duncan Keith has to back up. Nowitzki with a chip in. Stallberg flies in after the puck. Bumped with Ollie, and they both go down. Ryan Johnson. Centering pass. Kopecky shoots. Scores! What a shot. And Chicago's fourth line has a big shift to change the momentum again. 4-1 Hawks.
Well, Glenn talked about the Leafs trying to hit the defense of the Chicago Blackhawks. Here's a you get it, no, you get it. As both players come in, Stallberg initiates that contact. And Ollie gets knocked down, then loses the battle for the puck. Johnson with a great heads-up play, and this is a perfect shot. I mean, for Reimer, he's down early, but not a lot of players can put that up and over the goaltender. Glenn, you had a good angle there.
Yeah, down early, and there's been a number of teams that have exposed Reimer above the glove. That's the second goal of four tonight that's over his shoulder. He's a big guy, and what you see when you go to shoot isn't what you get. Doesn't look like there's top glove, looks like there's lots of 5-0, but by the time the release happens, well, top part of the net's wide open. He keeps his glove too low.
That was a big shift for a fourth line that doesn't play like a fourth line.
We're such a good cycle team, Chicago, and it's almost like a two-man cycle with a third player high. That's where you've got to be really defensively responsible, and they were on the bad part of the ice chasing to the good.
That's interesting coaching by Quenneville, though. You had a TV timeout, you had the game going a little flat, and he starts his third line first after the TV timeout and then comes back with his fourth. You didn't see a whole lot of that in the first.
Seabrook faked the shot. Now he takes one, and Gunnarsson tipped it out of play. So I guess he didn't like the first two lines and the way they were playing.
Well, one thing for sure, your own team knows your goalie better than anybody. And when warm-up, every single shot, well, not every single shot, but in this drill, about 7-8 in a row, trying to beat Reimer over the glove. And then tonight, two of the four over the glove.
There's the top line with Jonathan Toews winning the faceoff. Chris Campoli holds the puck in. Toews tipped it. Kane couldn't center for shot. Toronto now counters with its fourth line, and Tim Brent, Schustrom, and Brown had a great shift their last time out. And they played against the Toews line and outplayed them. Campoli to Campbell. Patrick Kane, Campoli can jump up, and he does. Toews goes to the net. There's the pass, and Reimer made sure that got to the boards. Campbell just about lost the puck. That is, fleet of foot allowed him to get to it. Toews, Kane, Campbell takes the shot. Campoli, Toews screening, hard pass across to Patrick Schuck. Stops up. Wanted that tip. Kane couldn't get it. Ryan Campbell to Patrick Kane, stripped to the puck. Brent couldn't clear it. And as Big Line keeps the puck in. Enough. Got the puck away from Toews. Ollie makes a play to Schuster, but he makes sure the puck gets out.
That was much more like the first period with this line. The good puck support. They out-support you. They got great patience with the puck, and they move it with such efficiency.
Here's Frolik with a shot. That deflected wide of the net. Bill Kessel starts out of his own zone. Got Lupo with it. Carroll Boyce centering this line now as Bozak continues to sit.
That's what you can't do against a guy like Keith. I mean, he's a great defender, has a good stick. Leafs have to try to out-support instead of try to beat everybody one-on-one like Kessel tried there.
Boyce looking for Lupo. And another nice play with the stick by Duncan Keith. And he turns back against the play. Gets some support from Jake Dowell. And the Hawks are out to center. Back in comes Boyce to Lupo. Kessel streaks towards the goal from the blue line. Brett Lebda into Luke Shen. His wrist shot tipped by Nick Leddy up into the netting. Thomas Kopecky has the latest Chicago goal on Hockey Night in Canada. Duncan Keith playing with Nick Leddy. You get three Chicago pairs that can play against any top line.
Well, and they can play offense, but they can also defend. And you see Phil Kessel here, there's just no room. A great mobility and an excellent active stick. Kessel gets another opportunity. Keith loses it, plays him hard, battles him, and then the puck's turned over again. And the frustration for Kessel is not finding open ice. You see the real difference in team play. Chicago right now, short passes, out supporting the Leafs. Right now, Toronto getting a little bit too individualistic.
Darryl Boyce centering Kessel and Leupel to take the draw against Ryan Johnson. Johnson with some hard work won the draw back. And gets the puck out. Johnson was just out for the faceoff.
You see how low he gets on that draw.
Pretty handy fourth line guy, don't you think? He
Absolutely.
Can kill some penalties, win some draws, and can handle playing 8 minutes a night.
Well, you look at Duncan Keith, and no surprise, first in the NHL, 30 minutes plus in 9 games, but 6 out of the first 8 of this year. You think about the changes in Chicago. His first 6 out of his first 8, he played over 30 minutes for the Hawks.
Put that in perspective, Dion Phaneuf has played 30 or more minutes one time. So this is a guy that logs all kinds of minutes against the best of the best in the world.
Skating shouldn't look that easy.
Yeah. One thing I love about him is he goes hard when he doesn't have the puck. He goes hard to get back to it so that when he does get it, he's got that extra second or two to make a play.
It reminds me of Brian Leetch in the sense that Brian would change. And I was beside him on a number of occasions, and he never looked tired, ever. Never came back to the bench winded. And that's what I see from Keith.
Here's Mikhail Grabowski driving wide with a shot over the head of Corey Crawford. Tomasarek with a shot, knocked down in front by Kuhlman, and if he touches it, it's a high stick. Well, the Blackhawks decide to play on, and they get the puck out. Tomasarek to center, Grabowski, 1-on-4, and the Blackhawks got the puck back. Here's Kopetsky to Ryan Johnson. Stahlberg drives towards the net. Kopetsky tried to get in the puck, and a good back check by Clark MacArthur came up with the puck. Turnover at the blue line, and there's Mike Tomasarek to pick up the puck.
You said it there, Jim, 1-on-4. It just seems too often it's 1 against 2 or 3 Chicago Blackhawks, and the result is a turnover.
Grabowski straight up the middle, stripped to the puck by Brian Campbell, loose in front, covered with a nice save off Joey Crabb, and a second one as well, and he smothers the puck.
Well, you talk about the play of Crawford. I mean, this is a broken play where a bouncing puck, Grabowski trying to beat three guys, loses it, but the puck comes right through. And watch Crawford, just no panic at all. Even gets bumped there by Crabb, but just stays square to the shooter, gets that paddle down, and nowhere to find a hole.
Such a big kid, big long legs, big pads.
Well, he had to wait for a long time for his chance while the Blackhawks spent a gazillion dollars bringing in goaltenders to work in front of him.
You almost get the sense that if you're going to beat him, it's got to be upstairs. The even, bottom part of the net just totally covered.
Even early in the year, you really got a sense that they were trying to force Marty Turco into that number one role, and it just wasn't happening. So he had to be a little patient even and wait for things to run its course.
Coming up Monday night, did the people of Taylor, B.C. reach their goal? Don't miss the dramatic season finale. How about that? A Village on a Diet. Tuesday night, Insecurity. It's Armed and Ridiculous. Insecurity at 8:30 following the Rick Mercer report. Tanner Bozak out for his first shift in quite some time. He's just the third line of Colby Armstrong and Joey Crabb up against Jonathan Toews' Chicago line. Dion Phaneuf. There's Bozak. Drops the puck off. Phaneuf with a shot snagged by the glove of Corey Crawford.
Well, what we haven't seen in this game is the second and third chances. Glenn mentioned earlier, maybe one of the weaknesses of Crawford early on was a lot of rebounds. But when they have been there, Chicago's been there to take them away. And in that kind of play, it's just a wasted shot putting it high like that. There's no chance for a rebound at all. You got to keep it down by his feet and try to create a second chance.
You know what's great too, when you're a goalie and there's a 7-game win streak, the Blackhawks have averaged 4.58 goals for a game. You can make a lot of mistakes if your team's scoring over 4 a game, can't you?
Absolutely.
Allows him to relax, and he hasn't made many mistakes. There's Brett Lepton with a shot that went off a stick. Shin. Held the puck in. Leupel. Luke Shin takes the shot. He wanted that to get to the front of the net for Tim Brent, and fronting it was Duncan Keith, and he skates right out to center and dumps the puck in. Tim Brent gets a shift here with Kessel and Leupel. Nick Chalmerson. aerial lift and knocks the puck down. Troy Brower comes up with it. Brent Seabrook hit Tim Brent at the bench.
That was a smart play by Seabrook. He was trying to get a too many men penalty.
Kessel snaps a shot and Crawford made the save.
He looked up and knew they were changing, so just threw it right at him. Almost worked.
Here's a chance for a two-on-one. Dave Boland shoots, rebound, Bickle scores! Boland and Bickle combined to make it 5-1 Chicago.
Well, this play started in the defensive zone. Seabrook just getting the puck out and clearing it. An elite defender knocked it down, and that created a chance. Gunnarsson's the man. He can't hold the bouncing puck. Now you got a two-on-one. The passing play wasn't there. And, boy, how often would you see that normally go off the shoulder and wide? A bit of a bad break there for Reimer. It hit his shoulder and went right down on the ice quickly. But a heads-up play by Bickle with his stick on the ice going hard to the net. Never a bad thing to do.
And you know what I like about Brian Campbell on that play? He had stepped on the ice for Seabrook and took about four strides towards the offensive zone. Goal goes in. He turns around at plus 25, goes back off so that Seabrook can get the plus that he deserves.
Bickle from Boland at 17:57, and with that goal, every one of Chicago's four lines has contributed to the offense tonight.
And you think early on that was going to be a question mark of this defending Stanley Cup team. You're in a position where, do they have the depth? Well, here it is. A fourth line scored, a third line, but look at the positioning. He goes right to the net. A lot of players would go by it. Instead, he goes right to that corner and gets the fortuitous bounce.
And it's a skill set, too. Not great hands, although he showed it there, but great speed. So he's going to beat you to the front of the net.
That's 16 for Bickle. His nickname is Dill. Kopetsky. Stahlberg watched by Carl Gunnarsson. There's Ryan Johnson to Brian Campbell, rolling puck. He shot it. Stahlberg tipped it. Reimer's got it. And it came loose, but the referee lost sight.
Well, you're just seeing the strengths of this Blackhawk team right now. The puck control, the patience in the offensive zone, protect the puck. And as soon as you just overplay them, they hit the wide open man. And the down low play, look at the efforts. There's no panic. Good positioning. You see the open man and a heads up play by Campbell. He had his head up the entire time, never looked at the puck, and got it to a position where he got it to the net and forced Reimer to battle for that loose puck.
Dave's line back on, jumping straight ahead is Colby Armstrong, and he came up with the puck. Joey Crabb, a two-on-two, gets the puck deep for Armstrong. Flips it back, Keith Ollie with a wrist shot, and Crawford way out of his blue crease makes the save and hangs on.
You know, we talk about Keith, you talk about the Norris, the offensive rushes, the great skating, but he understands as well, less is more. There is a time in the game when you don't have to do anything but just make the safe play. And we've seen Gunnarsson a couple times not make it. Gave up a two-on-one on the last play, turnover in the first period there. Hey, you know what? We're up by a field goal. Let's just put it deep. He puts it deep, and the next shift now, they're up by four.
There he lifts an aerial to center that Keith Ollie knocks down. Colby Armstrong takes the shot. Big rebound. Fimos fanned on it. And the puck comes all the way to center, and Ollie shoots it back in.
That's a better example there of that offside shot. Keep it low. Created a chance. Just a bouncing puck for Fanouf that he missed.
Fanouf in a little trouble again. Frolik with a centering pass. Now he has to go and fetch the puck. For Duncan Keith. He holds the puck in for Jake Gowell. He just tried to tip it in front. Brower had to come in and get it. Brower. Seabrook. His shot's blocked. Crabb trying to send Colby Armstrong away. Stalled at center ice. He shoots the puck in. Tim Brent threw the puck back out in front just as the second period comes to an end. Well, the Blackhawks haven't had very good third periods, but this is a tough, tough hill to climb for the Toronto Maple Leafs. Down by four. Brent Seabrook coming up with Elliott Friedman on Hockey Night in Canada with the Blackhawks in the lead on Hockey Night in Canada.
If you're a fan of the headrest, you've had a lot to clap about tonight. The Blackhawks up 5-1. It's been a good month, too, for Patrick Chartman, one of the 50 most beautiful Chicagoans. He actually, there was a female cover, Jennifer Hudson. They asked who was better. He got 80% of the vote, as you see J.S. Chiguerre now in goal for Toronto. But when he heard we were doing this, he said, Jim, please don't tell my teammates. I've taken enough abuse about it already.
Our own Glenn Healy's going to be on Gentleman's Quarterly soon as well.
I can tell you're really far up there in the Foster Hewitt gondola.
Yeah. There's the sharp-dressed man moving the puck in.
Once they get the addition with kilts on it, I have a chance.
5-1 Chicago to start the third period. Early in the season, the Blackhawks just had awful third periods, gave up a lot of leads, and they have still given up more goals. Only Atlanta, Colorado, and Ottawa have given up more goals in the third period than Chicago, and the puck is out of play.
Yeah, it's a penalty. Yeah, that one was knocked out of midair by Nick Leddy. So the third period doesn't start well again, and this is one of those plays, a bouncing puck, and he just got it out of midair right there and out. So Don won't like that one either.
Not many games around the league where you get a little breathing room in the third period like Chicago has. We know Joel Quenneville, who never looks like he's satisfied, or probably be worried that there'll be a letdown in this period.
Chicago Valley, number 8, Nick Lane.
Well, when you're going on a clip like they've been, 7 in a row, 9-1-2 in their last 12, you don't want to let the pedal off the metal. You got to make sure you get your points now. You mentioned how precarious they are to ninth. But they can also look ahead, too, and try to get even home ice.
Here's Dion Phaneuf moving into the power play. Has Tim Print out in front of the net. The only man back at the point right now is Phil Kessel. Joffrey Leupel, Tyler Bozak, Phil Kessel back together again on this power play. A power play that's 0 for 2 in the game. Phaneuf with his shot off the end of Crawford's glove. Leupel checked by Brian Campbell. Kessel takes over. Dion Phaneuf sets him up. Kessel walks in, won't shoot. Now he takes the shot. Crawford the save. Bouncing puck is loose in front. And Ryan Johnson was able to get it over to Brian Campbell, who cleared it. Tyler Bozak starts the breakout and then heads for the bench and a change. Luke Shen's rink-wide pass deflected right onto the Leaf bench. But here's how tight it is in the Western Conference, where things can change on a nightly basis, and why Chicago's Joel Quenneville wants to keep the pedal to the metal, because at 78 points, they're still just 3 points ahead of all those teams at 75.
Hard to believe, isn't it? It's never been so close and involved so many teams. No wonder coaches get ulcers.
You think those teams at the top, Vancouver and Detroit, would like to meet Chicago in the first round?
Absolutely not. I mean, we are getting a full example of it, how dangerous they will be.
It's just taken them so long to get this sorted out. Their top players weren't their top players, other than Taves in the early part of the season. They were trying to get some symmetry, introduce some new guys. It took forever to sort out their lines.
And their goaltending.
And Crawford is taken over now. Marty Turco hasn't played in a month.
I feel for Turco, because when he did play well early, that's when the team was in their funk. And they didn't get run support for him. And I've been in that seat before, where you put up a good game, team doesn't score. And when you do have a soft one, they manage to get a couple, and they're all looking at you like it's you're doing.
Here's Carl Gunnarsson. Luke Shen set up. There's MacArthur's shot, and that's blocked and cleared by Duncan Keith.
That's really been the bane of the power play the last while, just not getting shots through, not even giving yourself a chance for a lucky goal, a second chance goal.
Nikolai Kuhlman, as the penalty's about to expire, Nick Letty's back on. Toronto's 0 for 3 in the power play, 0 for its last 20 now. Chris Campoli, Patrick Kane, Patrick Sharp, forced to his back end by Krabowski. Taves comes in and didn't get much of a shot away, it got blocked. Taves poked the puck to Kane. Sharp with a one-timer, just missed the net. Campoli to Taves. Sharp had the puck snatched away.
His number 10 reminds us that 10 different Chicago players have points in the game tonight. Real team effort in a 5-1 lead. Chris Campoli, he got rocked hard by Brown, who's had a couple of hits. Here's Kane, cuts into the middle, takes the shot, and J.S. Jaguar, tested by Patrick Kane, makes the save.
Well, we saw earlier the picture of Stan Bowman watching his team, and Jim, you talked about how long it took to bring things together, but I like the moves that they made at the end. You think about bringing in Campoli on the back end, gives him a little bit, again, more mobility back there, but how about Michael Frolik, too? He scored a goal in this game, and one of the questions was going to be, was the depth of this team as good as it was in the past? Now, all of a sudden, a guy who's had back-to-back 20 goals can play down in your third line or even fourth line at times. And all of a sudden, things looking a little bit more rosy for the defending champ.
Here's a question. Oh, David Boland is on the ice right now. He's a great third-line player, terrific in the playoffs. Ollie with a shot. Brent threw the puck to the front of the net. Here's Keith Ollie. Keeps this play alive. Komisarek with a shot that whistles wide of the net. Ollie on the other side makes a little back pass. Just, no, it wasn't onside. So can Dave Boland play with top offensive players? They've tried to move him up to a second line center before, and it hasn't worked out because he's a perfect third line guy.
And Jim, it's not even so much the question, can he play, because he's been a prolific scorer at the junior level. It's, do you want him to? You think of how effective he was in the Vancouver series of driving Henrik and Daniel Sedin absolutely crazy. You almost want him as a coach in that role, and you're forcing him into position of playing a different role when you got to play with Hossa offensively.
Part of it too, guys, you had Kopecky and Versteeg last year, pretty good line, but then because of bonus players, Chicago was penalized $4.5 million.
There's a tip for the bouncing puck, hits the back of the net, and Toronto has its second. Joey Crabbe got the last tip.
That's a good play by Luke Shen. He mentioned the fact that the Leafs haven't been able to get anything through to the net. And this is one, a little mobility on the top, a bouncing puck that doesn't get cleared. But look at just a little hesitation by Shen there. Went off of Crabbe and then maybe even Armstrong in front too. And that's something that the Leafs have been working on, getting some mobility at the top in practice. And that one gets through, gets deflected. Did it get deflected twice? It hit off Crabbe. Now does it hit off? No, the skate of Seabrook.
So it'll be Crabbe's goal.
It will be Crabbe's goal.
And the angle that Frolik takes to go out to block that, he's going from outside to inside. If he gets in the lane, there's no chance for that wrist shot to go through.
That's something on the blue line there. Elliot Friedman saying practice yesterday. Rob Zettler working with Luke Shen on that very play, getting the puck at the top of the blue line, moving it laterally and getting a shot through, and it pays off for a goal.
Let's see if that goal got the Blackhawks' attention, because they looked like a pretty relaxed team in the early part of the third period with the big lead.
Yeah, you get caught into playing a bit of a no-hitter, don't you? You just try to get the clock to go faster, and all of a sudden it's back to being a game.
Kopecky, Stahlberg, and Johnson, that's the fourth line now. Bozak, the loophole, the puck was behind him, and the play goes offside.
Well, part of the reason for the goal is the shot gets through, and watch to the front of the net. Seabrook, it is normal in a game like this when you're up by four that you really want to block shots, you really want to pay the price. Tight game, you would. It's like Chicago, when you're trying to block a shot, get in the way. Don't jump out of the way. But you can see why when you're up by four.
Patrick Sharp to Patrick Kane. Good play by Keith Ollie. Jaguar out to meet the puck. Phillip up the boards. Kuhlman trying to clear the puck. Kept in by Liddy. His shot is blocked. That'll send Grabowski away. Streaking to the net. Tipped up. Should be a penalty shot. And it is. Grabowski with a penalty shot to make it a two-goal game.
Well, the block shot. You talked about the importance of it. Letty doesn't get it through. Grabowski does a nice job of getting that leg out. The reason why he's got his legs so wide, he knew that Seabrook was going to come with the stick and got a little bit of a shot, but clearly not a good one. And no question about that penalty. Didn't get puck at all, went right on the foot of Grabowski.
And the worst part for the goaltender Crawford is on that play, he's lost his edge on his skate. He's got to play the last 14-20 with his skate banging up against the post. He's lost his edge.
And the problem is you don't use that same kind of quick skate sharpener with a goaltender's blade.
No,
it's not the same.
Wider blade, you're right, Simmer.
But now he's going to get back in the goal with a dull skate and face Mikhail Krabowski, who's been extremely creative in his shootouts. Let's see what he comes up with as the fans of the Air Canada Centre come to their feet for a penalty shot. They'll tell you how he does. Just about made the Forsberg move and got it by Crawford, who snagged it, and it stays 5-2.
Well, great idea, but the importance of this idea is speed, where you get the goaltender sliding across. Look at how slow, and somehow that edge must be good enough, Glenn Healy, because he was able to dig in and get from his right back to his left and get the pad right on top of him.
Now, big, long legs covers the bottom of the net. It's either got to be your right speed or upstairs.
That would have made things pretty interesting.
Absolutely. And Duncan Keith is off the bench of the Chicago Blackhawks, and we'll have to see if it is an injury. He blocked a shot on that penalty kill. It hit him in the hand, and he sort of shook it. But now, after that penalty shot, he went in back into the dressing room. So that's a big loss on the back end, not having him.
And another third period for Chicago. Looks like it's going sideways. Leon put up, trying to keep the pressure on. Mark MacArthur, bouncing puck, just keeps it onside. Boland blocked the shot. Slapped that out to center. And Grabowski's there to pick up the puck, stripped by Hossa. He tripped up MacArthur, and the fans call a penalty. The referees don't. Here's Grabowski. He hasn't stopped. Checked by Jake Dowell. He becomes a pretty important player now for Chicago, too, with Boland moved up to play with Hossa. Dowell's the third line center. Luke Shen out of the reach of Mike Brown. Chris Campoli has the puck. Ryan Campbell to center. Tim Brent is there. Brown shoots the puck back in. Schustrom couldn't get a hold of the puck. In the second effort, keeps it in. Tim Brent stops, and his stick was checked by Campoli. Lebda pinched in to keep the puck in. Now he backs up defensively, and Chicago finally gets out of its own zone. A turnover by Bauer. Here's Brown. Stopped by Clifford. Big save by Corey Crawford on Mike Brown. Here they come again. Tim Brent. Centering pass right out in front. Shen with a shot. That's blocked. Lepka. Kessel. Shen can't hold the puck in. Or Komisarek make that. Can't hold the puck into the line. Jaguar comes out to meet it. Well, there's a couple of things that, had they gone in Toronto's favor, would make this an entirely different game.
Timing's everything in it. I mean, a turnover, but it's a turnover to Brown, not known as a goal scorer.
Here's Tyler Bozak.
The next shift out, that was Lupo in the same spot.
Yeah.
Might have been a different ending.
I think Joel Quenneville was sensing the same thing as he pointed to his bench and said, it goes that way.
It was Troy Brower that made the turnover. Here's a long pass for Bozak. He's on his own, delays, buys some time, and had his pass intercepted by Patrick Sharp. Taken away again. Fanuf shot wide. Kessel in front. Lupo deflected it. Couldn't get it on goal. Lupo again turns and shoots. And that was blocked, and Sharp starts out. Here's Patrick Kane. Patrick Sharp stopped by Jaguar. Sharp on this big line can't buy one tonight. Ryan Campbell wide of the net. A sloppy third period for the Blackhawks with a 5-1 lead now at 5-2. Jonathan Taves. Patrick Kane in traffic, stripped to the puck. And the Leafs are able to clear it.
Good news for the Hawks. Keith is back on the bench.
Here comes Sharp with a shot, and Shakir makes the save. Carroll Boyce off the glass and out. Armstrong. Nice move by Crabbe, and then he tried to pass, and Seabrook blocked it before it got to Darryl Boyce. You saw the penalty shot by Grabowski, his first in his career, and Crawford has now faced two of them and stopped them both. And he also made a big save off Mike Brown.
Yeah, Brown frustrated, a turnover by Troy Brouwer right in the middle of the ice, walking in all alone and chose the quick shot, but great positioning by Crawford, didn't overplay it, just came out. And here's a timeout by Joel Quenneville. As an icing, a tired team. Kane has been out there about a minute and a half at least. And I think that more than anything, some tired bodies.
That gives us a chance to take a break and have a look at our hockey night close-up for Subway Restaurants, brought to you by Subway Restaurants and bringing you Marian Hossa.
Well, when the Blackhawks lost Martin Havlat, they picked up the best player available, and this guy's been nothing but lights out. He had his dream last year of winning a Stanley Cup. He is one of the most complete three-zone players. Watch the strength that he exhibits. Puck sticks to his stick as long as he wants it. He can score, he can check, he can play well. He's one of those guys who has the entire package and is a complete three-zone player.
Here's Patrick Kane darting out to center. Bickle with a shot, and that's stopped by J.S. Shakir. He closes the door again, and his team's had some life in the third period. Still down by three, though, on Hockey Night in Canada. Hockey's version of the Brady Bunch features all four goaltenders, a couple of young ones, a couple of vets.
Yeah, passing of the torch, you know, J.S. Shakir, 500 more games played than Reimer. Reimer got the start. And how about Turco, 489 more games played than Crawford, but Crawford has taken over the torch. Hey, when you put it into perspective, J.S. Shakir has 67 ties. Both rookie goaltenders have 69 wins combined. So it's been a real change of the guard. The young guys have taken over in both nets.
Good thing for Chicago that Marty's such a likable, easygoing guy. He's handled this very professionally. And even though he's not playing all the time, he's still got a chance to win.
And you know, at some point, you're going to need him. I mean, the way goaltenders get bumped around, something happens, you get a chance to get back in there, you know you've got a guy with experience.
He, like a lot of guys who weren't on the Stanley Cup team last year, still get a chance to go to the White House on Friday. Hjalmarsson to Seabrook. Back half of this third period. Brian Bickle.
Philadelphia last year. How long did it take him to go to Michael Layton? A couple rounds, and the next thing you know, he's in the Stanley Cup final as the go-to guy.
Michael Frolik got by Gunnarsson. Take it by Brett Lebda. Lebda's played a lot more tonight for Toronto. Frolik holds the puck in. Gets some help from Brian Campbell. Time-eating shift for Chicago here. Just cycling along the boards. Fredrik Sjöström is out to center, and he dumps the puck in. Racing is Mike Brown. Just got out of the way of a Campoli hit. Brouwer back for the puck. No turnover this time. He made sure he got the puck in the air out to center. Just. Left his shooting. Look at a rare foray out to play the puck for Crawford. Ryan Johnson off the boards. Here's Victor Stahlberg with a great wheels. Cut to the net. And he's drawn a penalty here with his speed.
He's taken a penalty. He's going to get interference on the goalie. Stahlberg going hard to the net, draws the call.
Power play coming up for Toronto. Victor Stahlberg still in disbelief. His speed was his enemy here. He got to the net, but he got a penalty.
And he got the inside positioning and then just couldn't stop himself. There was a quick call. There's Duncan Keith. And you see that one finger that he's not bending there. He's keeping it straight. He blocked the shot, and he, I think, is just going to sit here for moral support on the bench. because he hasn't played since he's come back.
Toronto on the power play for the fourth time in the game. 0 for 3. Dion Phaneuf to Tim Brent off the one draw. Nikolai Kuhlman with Grabowski high in the slot. Phaneuf's one-timer blocked by Ryan Johnson. He's one of the best at that, although it's hurt him a few times. He's had all sorts of problems with his feet and his fingers from blocking shots. Here's Tim Brent. Straight ahead. MacArthur's with him. Here's Brent. Phaneuf to Brent, and MacArthur looks to the net. Kuhlman screening. Brent Seabrook breaks up the play. Can't clear the puck. Brent to Phaneuf. Tim Brent again. Round the outside. MacArthur and Grabowski pass the puck back and forth. There's Seabrook trying to break up a play. Here's Clark MacArthur. Chalmerson misses him in the check. Jonathan Toews to help out, and the puck comes back to Phaneuf. He stops it on the line. MacArthur looks at the net, takes the shot, hit his own man in front of the goal. Bouncing puck! And MacArthur was right there, had an open net, but the puck was bouncing on it. Seabrook clears the puck, hammers it all the way down the ice.
Great job by Jalmerson getting across, and he saved that goal there. There's a talk about getting pucks through for those second and third chances.
Carl Gunnarsson to Brent Lipka. In deep for Tyler Bozak. Bill Kessler's had a pretty quiet night around the outside here. Couldn't come up with a puck. Lipka. And for Kessel, he turns around, lost control, and Sharp clears the puck. One last rush on this power play. Kessel leads the way. Gets by Hossa. Takes it by Ryan Johnson. Campoli clears the puck, and Stahlberg set to come back on. Toronto's 0 for 4 on the power play. Bozak trying to get to the net. Lupo follows him, had his stick hooked. Lebda can't bury it. That's blocked. Corey Crawford makes the save, and the penalty will go against Chicago.
Well, they've had their chances, haven't they?
Boy, they have.
To make this game interesting. And you got to wonder, Joel Quenneville just shaking his head. Speed through that neutral zone coming in. Lupo and Hossa forced to make the hook to save a goal. Now here's Duncan Keith on that penalty kill earlier in the period. A good hard shot by Keith Ollie, and it hit him right in the hand. I mean, he's got his hands in front right on the stick. And a lot of times what happens is it gets pinned against the stick. Now he's trying to feel, can I hold on to a stick? And Jim, I would say Joel Quenneville now wisely. It's 5-2 game,
yep.
Late in the game. Why put him out there? And I don't think you'll see him again. Interesting that he comes to the bench though, huh?
Didn't want to miss the exciting conclusion. Consecutive power plays. Phaneuf with a shot that's blocked. And you know, when you see Duncan Keith block that shot, you know a defenseman's going to be out there killing a penalty. But that's one of the reasons a lot of teams don't have their top forwards kill penalties, because you don't want to lose one with a broken finger.
And you know, the problem too, guys, when you take these penalties is that you run that risk. You know, you're going to have to block shots, and there's always the potential of a broken foot, broken finger. And the big boys do the killing. Hossa does some killing. Toews does killing. Broken finger, that's going to kill you.
Here's Tim Brent on the power play. Dion Phaneuf walks in, fires, great save by Crawford. Snatched that out of the air with his glove hand.
That had to feel good. I mean, there's one that great positioning. He's out aggressively. Watch how square he is to the shooter. Looking around the screen, and there's one where Colby Armstrong was there, but he didn't get into the vision of the goaltender. Look, he's off to the side. He jumps, and Crawford saw it the whole way, and a great athletic reflex save.
Grabowski got the draw. Dion Phaneuf to Tim Brent. Kuhlman parks in front of the net. Grabowski with Colby Armstrong now taking over in front. Kuhlman turns to the net. And in comes Tim Brent, and the play is stopped. There's going to be a penalty called in front of the net. It's Colby Armstrong getting the gate.
Well, I mentioned the fact that, you know, when you're screening in there, you got to do your job and get in the vision of the goaltender. And Armstrong's been off to the side. He was getting boxed out by Campbell. And that one's okay, but watch the second one. Campbell goes down easily. There's where the argument comes. He felt that he went down too fast, didn't get another chance at it.
An interference call.
barely a touch. So four on four.
You know how it goes, though, guys, right? Referee, there's lots of communication.
Yeah.
Let you know, don't do it.
Yeah.
And then you follow it up 3 seconds later by doing it again. Let it go once, but not twice. No matter how incidental.
I think he's just mad because if he knew he was going to get a penalty, they drilled him. Kane and Taves are on the ice 4-on-4, and Campoli jumps into the rush. He'll get some time here where Duncan Keith might be playing. And Campbell, good offensive defenseman on the ice. Bozak has to chase the puck. Campoli got back first. Ryan Campbell. Drop pass. Here's Patrick Kane to Campbell. Passes back in front. Gobbled up by Joey Crabb to Tim Brandt. In on Nicoletti. Frolik back the other way. He's got Bolden with it. 2-on-1. Frolik tried to pass instead of a shot at 5-2. Trying to be unselfish. And the Leafs break it up. And out they start. Brent Seabrook now. Teammates are changing. Patrick Sharp comes on with Frolik. Seabrook with the shoot and turns Phaneuf. Worked out pretty well. Frolik got in there in a hurry and got the puck back. Heath Hawley. Back on comes Hossa. Chicago with a man advantage. Luke Shen with a shot off a skate in front of the net. Keith Ollie on the other side with a shot. Crawford stops that and he covers up to stop play with 26 seconds left in the Armstrong penalty and the Chicago power play. Tuesday at 9 o'clock, join Ron McLean and Cassie Campbell-Pascal as they reveal the top 10 Kraft Hockeyville finalists. After the show, you can vote to help determine which town will have a chance to be Kraft Hockeyville 2011. Grabowski goes straight ahead on the draw. Campoli's back for the puck. Bickle rink wide for David Bolin. Luke Shen, first man back in his own zone. Armstrong set to come back on the ice. And he might be able to join a rush here. Kuhlman crisscrossing. Grabowski follows him. Takes the shot. Crawford makes a blocker save. He's had to be sharp in his third period, hasn't he? Armstrong's penalty's expired. And the teams are 5-on-5, and the Leafs are running out of time on a night where they got a little lesson from the Stanley Cup champs. Troy Brower off the wing. And a rebound to Komisarek. Blackhawks have been just sloppy enough in the third period to keep their coach on edge. Hawks 5, Leafs 2, 3:08 to go. Up 5-2 late in the third, and Joe Quenneville still has a scowl. I wonder if he'll smile at the White House, Glenn.
As is your tradition, here's another tradition. They will go there Friday, but the Stanley Cup rings. There's mine on the left. Look at the Blackhawks have put me to shame. It's with 30 grand, will buy you. The president has one responsibility. Pronounce the captain's name right. And Clinton did not get Yzerman. So, guys upstairs, what is the over-under in Obama, who is a very busy man, getting Jonathan Toews right? That is going to be a tough one, and I'm waiting with bated breath.
There's a scramble around Crawford's net again. Shots are 32-25 Toronto in this game. There's been a scrambly third period where the Leafs have been the better team. Nick Leddy is the player without his helmet. Ollie pinches in. Jake Dowell. An aerial backhander. Frolik will chase it. Leon Phaneuf looks after him. Well, for a minute there he did. Campoli. Campbell's open. That's a spinorama again. That's the second one he's done. And he makes a pass back to Campoli. Patrick Kane. Hey. So for the Blackhawks, another terrific first period tonight. They got an early lead of 3-0. Up the middle, here's Kane. Backhander missed the net. This will be their 8th consecutive win. And they'll head for Florida tonight. A couple of days in a warm temperature. Play Florida and Tampa Bay Tuesday, Wednesday. Jonathan Toews. The Leafs use up their game in hand on Carolina and stay 4 points back. Brown to the front of the net. Poke check by Crawford on Schuster. And out to center. Toews just missed the puck and Jaguar will play it.
I wonder now how long Corey Crawford's going to keep the net. Whether he does get a night off. He's playing so well and the team's playing great in front of him. Talked about how tight the standings are. It'll be interesting to see what Joel Quenneville does.
Well, there's a few different times though in this 5-2 lead and victory that Chicago will get where this could have changed considerably and gotten the other way.
Big save.
Luke Shen shoots and scores. Been a minute to go and it's a 5-3 game.
You're right, Jim. You think of all the opportunities. It's a two-goal game with a minute left. Had that penalty shot gone the right way. Luke Shen, not known for his goal-scoring prowess from the point, but this is a rocket through a screen. As Hjalmarsson was in position, couldn't get it. His first goal in 29 games beats him stick side to Corey Crawford.
All you got to do is make the safe play up the boards, watch the clock tick away. Goes up the middle, and now you're back to center.
With 57 seconds to go. Shots are 13-6 in favor of Toronto in the third period.
Now you're really sitting going, man, missed so many chances. You could have made it interesting. Now the goalie's trying to get out, but Jaguar now will get himself to the bench.
Simmer, a minute into the game, Kuhlman had a 2-on-1. It could be a different game if he cashes in there.
And the Leafs just had a poor start. I mean, they didn't finish that chance, but they had too many turnovers, were a little late starting, and they paid for it. Grabowski, the extra attacker on. Boland blew a tire, but he gets up and gets the puck. Well, on a big stage in Canada, Corey Crawford gets to shine. And the Stanley Cup champions look all right. A stop in play with 4 seconds to go. And the Foster Hewitt broadcast gondola with the Blackhawks ahead 5-3 as they head for Florida. And an updated look at the standings.
Well, you think of the Leaf fans this afternoon watching Buffalo go down 2-0 against Philadelphia early. But they storm back. So not only are they chasing Carolina and the Rangers. Next week on Hockey Night in Canada, the Buffalo Sabres, a big game as well.
And in between, they have to make sure that they don't streak the other direction. They have a big game against the Islanders on Tuesday. So the Blackhawks win this one 5-3, a big team effort with 10 different players getting scoring points. Tampa Bay, Montreal are still playing. Let's join them now. Here's Bob Cole.
And we say hello to everybody on Hockey Night in Canada from coast to coast. To the St. Pete Times Forum, we welcome you, where the Montreal Canadiens are leading the Tampa Bay Lightning by a score of 4-2. And on the clock, we see 1:17 remaining. You're looking at a timeout that has been called, and the coaching staff of the Tampa Bay Lightning are going over everything they can.